Time is 7 p.m. on February 27th, Monday. And welcome everybody to this meeting of the Wooddale Community Development Commission. My name is Jamie Ochoa and I am the chairman for this committee. Will Stacy please do roll call?
Yes.
Yeah.
Commissioner Babowitz?
Here.
Commissioner Jager Rutnicki? Commissioner Parenti?
Here.
Commissioner Peterson? Commissioner Sacco?
Here.
Commissioner Woods? And Chairman Ochoa?
Here.
Chairman, you have a quorum.
Thank you. Our first business item, we need a motion to approve the meeting minutes from January 16th, 2023. Can I get a motion?
Make a motion to approve.
I don't have, but I'm sure they're correct.
Can I get a second?
Second.
All in favor, say yay. Yay.
Yay.
All opposed? Minutes carry, motion passes. Okay, moving on. You see, that's what happened when you don't follow the script. Moving on to our second business item, CDC training, Ms. Springer and Mr. Conway, can you please facilitate the training?
Absolutely. Thank you. We are going to divide and conquer this evening. I will take the first 14 or so slides, and then our attorney will chime in with the legal perspective and analysis kind of towards the end. So I'm going to cover the basics. We haven't had a training in 2.5 years, so it was in September of 2020 was the last training. So it's a good, you know, we're probably overdue. Since then, we have had 3 new members, although one of them isn't here this evening. But it's also a good refresher, I think, for all of the existing members. So we've put together a short PowerPoint. The first slide is a quote that is generally attributed to Ben Franklin. If you fail to plan, you are planning to fail. Of course, all planners agree with this quote. The second quote is from a source unknown, but that says, if you don't know where you're going, how do you know when you've arrived? Thus the importance of planning. We need to know where we're going. So this is really some general overall kind of background, setting the stage for planning, city planning, why we do it, how it gets done, what the process is, what the framework is. So this first slide talks a little bit about the importance of planning. And the goal of planning is to maximize the health, safety, and economic well-being for all residents. And it includes attracting and retaining thriving businesses and working to create communities of lasting value where people want to live, work, and play. You'll see the words economic well-being up there. And obviously, all property owners in the city want their property values to be maintained or increase. And so a lot of the regulations in the codes that we administer tend to set rules and regulations to keep properties, keep property values high. So consistency in neighborhood districts, consistent setbacks. What you can't do, you can't store a lot of equipment in somebody's backyard because it might detract from the neighbor. So, and also safety and health. So what planners do is we take a broad look at the community and envision how it should grow, how it should change, and what it should offer residents in the future. And so planning helps set a shared direction with the community. So not only do we as city staff and city volunteers, elected officials know where we're headed, but also the whole community can know where we're headed. What's the vision we want this community to look like in the future? Planning also helps bring the community together. So during our goal setting and our comprehensive long-range planning, we get people from the community involved so we can hear from them, and so we can jointly kind of set this vision of where we want to go. And we also, you know, get in contact with people if they show up for public meetings or any type of long-range planning activities, or they, you know, come because they're interested at public hearings. So having kind of a consistent common end goal with members of the communities it allows us to have some good, consistent decision-making. It kind of takes the question out of it. Is this a good thing for the community? Well, we've all sat down and decided what we want the community to look like, what we think should go where, and so it assists us in consistent decision-making. Planning also helps us align our resources for budgeting. So like infrastructure improvements or identifying maybe properties that the city council wants us to focus on for redevelopment. Maybe we invest our budgeting resources in acquiring some of those properties and helping make that redevelopment happen. So as long as we know what we want to be and we can plan for that, then we can allocate the appropriate resources in the appropriate areas. So the planning framework. One of the first things we obviously want to do is set a future vision for the community, and we do that through long-range plans, in particular the comprehensive plan. The comprehensive plan did include a public process. We actually, I looked back at it, it was done in 2018, and we had a steering committee that met a number of times, open houses, so people from the community were invited to come and find out more about it. Stakeholder interviews, so key people in the community involved in various organizations or groups. We had individual interviews with them. We had information available on a website. We were obviously using all of our outreach tools, either through surveys or newsletters, e-newsletters, and mailed postcards. So we adopted that, as I mentioned, in 2018, and we did have a lot of people involved in making that shared vision. So Wooddale is obviously a built-out, mature community, but it doesn't mean that there isn't the potential for lots of, you know, improvement or redevelopment or reinvestment. And so some of these properties can probably be redeveloped for a higher and better use that's more useful to the community and more beneficial to the property owners. Neighborhood planning is a little bit different. So, you know, the comprehensive plan looks at the whole community, but neighborhood planning is really for smaller scale areas. So in the comp plan, there are sections called sub-areas, and it takes a look at a specific geographic area that makes sense to group, and then focus on options for that particular area. So let's say, you know, kind of the city center, where we envision our city center to be, which is the intersection of Wooddale Road and Irving Park Road. That is the city center area, so there's a section in the comprehensive plan that focuses just on that. So after we have a vision and we have some goals, obviously the comprehensive plan is more general in nature. It doesn't have really specific, you must have this here, but it gives you kind of a direction of, hey, these are appropriate uses for these locations. So the regulations are, for example, are our zoning and subdivision regulations, which we combine in this community into what we call the UDO, Unified Development Ordinance, because it's unified. Lots of other communities may have a separate zoning ordinance and a separate subdivision regulations, but we've grouped them together. And they are technical specifications that help us achieve the goals in the comprehensive plan. So for example, there are regulations that establish what uses are permitted in various districts, and bulk regulations that you're familiar with, like lot coverage and setbacks and height regulations, again, for consistency purposes. And these are regulations, so if somebody doesn't want to comply with those, they have to seek relief from those, obviously, as you know, if it's even allowed for relief to be sought for certain matters. Design guidelines, the second thing on the screen, are a little bit different. So these are actually guidelines, not regulations. They're not rules or laws. They're suggestions, let's say, on how to achieve a particular character for a certain area or a neighborhood. So they don't say you have to have a certain type of design, like you know, neoclassical or something like that. But rather what it does is it encourages quality materials, quality design, quality landscaping, and it can help us set get a type of character for a neighborhood. For example, if you have a 25-foot setback, that brings your house closer to the street. If you encourage porches and you require sidewalks, that promotes a sense of neighborhood and engagement, a character for that community. People will sit out on their front porches. They might engage more with their neighbors that are passing by, and that's a character that we have in our design regulations that we try to achieve with those suggestions. So what is a comprehensive plan? I've already talked about it quite a bit. It looks at the entire community, and it ties together all sorts of things like infrastructure, housing, recreation, transportation, community facilities. The plan itself is comprehensive, meaning all of those things. It sets some long-range goals. So the goals that we're setting are for about 10 years out, 5 to 10 years out. Some communities go as long as 15 or 20 years, but really things change dramatically enough in 10 years where you should consider, updating your comprehensive plan. It should also be updated periodically. Now, we've adopted ours in 2018, and from what I understand, we have not done an update. And so that is something that is on our radar that we would like to accomplish in 2023. There's been some things where, again, comprehensive plan is a guiding tool. We've not necessarily, done exactly what the comprehensive plan said because maybe circumstances changed or things in the community, physical things in the community have changed, or people's opinions have changed. And so we want to make sure we maintain an updated comprehensive plan. So like I said, we hope to do that this year. The comprehensive plan is general, meaning it's not specific. It sets out those guides and policies and shows you possibilities. It focuses on the physical development realm, really, what would it look like? You try to see what you would like to be there, and then you can refine that a little bit more to give even better direction. I mentioned before, it aligns with the city's resources. So we'll take those goals and we'll match them with how we budget. For example, capital improvement programming. There's a, in one of the upcoming slides, it might be the next one, no? But it talks about, maybe where we might want a community kind of park. And, in order to improve that, we would need to plan for that in our capital improvement plan years out. And so that's how the comprehensive plan is involved in our budgeting. It's also a policy instrument. It helps guide our policies that we establish, but it can be subject to change, and the UDO identifies how it should be updated through amendments. So this is the cover of our plan. The UDO defines the comprehensive plan as a compilation of policy statements, goals, standards, maps, recommended planning, regulatory, fiscal, and public works programs, together with pertinent data relative to the past, present, and future trends of the city with respect to its population, housing, economic, social, and environmental development patterns, its land, water, and natural resources, and use, its transportation facilities, public facilities, and utilities, and any other matter relative to the present and future patterns of life within the city. That's a big definition for something that really is, if you just think about it, as a vision and a guide. Yes, sir.
Is this online?
It is. Mm-hmm. But the UDO is interesting because it actually says in there, our comprehensive land use plan. Usually a land use plan is a component of the comprehensive plan, but our UDO says our comprehensive land use plan consists of three forward-thinking documents. So, these visionary documents. It's not just this. It's the vision plan, and that was done in 2015. I don't know if anybody's ever taken a look at it. It's another long-range planning document developed a few years earlier, also on the city's website. But again, it's a vision of what we might want to see in the future. And then the Homes for a Changing Region plan. I'm sorry, that's 2015, the vision plan is 2013, and any amendments to those documents. So it's the comp plan, the vision plan, and the Homes for a Changing Region plan, all of which are on our website. So collectively, those three documents comprise the official policy of the city regarding existing and developing character of the various areas of the city. These are the chapters that you'd or components that you generally see in a comprehensive plan. It's pretty much where most places have a very consistent list of these are the chapters that you'll find. These are exactly our chapters. We have 11 of them. One of the first things that the stakeholder groups do trying to identify the existing condition summary is they do a SWOT analysis. Evaluate what are our strengths, weaknesses, what are our opportunities, our strengths, and it helps us assess kind of what our existing conditions are. And of course, the next step is public engagement. We obviously did that, and pretty much every single plan, long-range plan that I'm aware of, includes that element. And then from the input that we gather from those two exercises, we develop the goals and objectives. But we want them to be views that are shared with our public, and that's why we include them. Market overview and economic development, really, you know, evaluating what our opportunities are for encouraging future economic development and maintaining what we have. Infrastructure is another, number seven. If you want to attract industries or business from your community, you better make sure you have the internal or underground framework to be able to accommodate those businesses. So, you know, do you have a variety of modes of transportation? We are fortunate to have a train that runs right through our downtown of our community. Do you want bike paths? We need bike racks now per the UDO to accommodate people that want to bike, or and also walking paths. Recreation. That chapter looks at what facilities do we have available in the community? What are we missing? What are opportunities for improving those items, recreational areas that we have available for the community? And housing, there's always a chapter on housing because we want to know, are we serving the needs of our community based on the housing that we've made available, that we have available? In some communities, like the North Shore communities, there isn't enough sufficient affordable or attainable housing. In some other communities, there's not enough workforce housing. Are there, you know, ownership and rental and different, you know, types of housing that are available at different sizes and price points? So that's always included. This is actually a page. This is kind of an example of a corridor or neighborhood plan. This is a page of the 2013 Downtown Vision Plan. And what it is a community park that's envisioned in a quadrant of our city core. So that is the northwest corner of Irving Park and Wooddale Road, right north of the tracks. And what that plan shows is a possibility. We could develop that property to create a community gathering space with a garden, a pavilion, relocating the barn, the historic barn north on Wooddale Road to that area, make it a park, and we could have a space for festivals. So this is kind of an example of a neighborhood or a sub-area type plan. So once we have all those visioning plans in place, this actually harkens back to when I was talking about the UDO earlier, we have to regulate development with various codes, and we do so with these main codes. So our UDO, the stormwater, and these are all chapters of our city code. City code is also available online, has 19 chapters. Chapter 17 is our UDO. Chapter 10 is our stormwater regulations. Now, we are required, because the community is in DuPage County, to adopt the DuPage County Stormwater Protection, Floodplain and Protection Ordinance, big long acronym. And all properties in DuPage County have to follow that plan. And actually, quite honestly, DuPage County is one of the most advanced when it comes to stormwater planning in the state, and for, you know, in many places in the United States. The stormwater ordinance that they have is a model for what other counties are trying to achieve. But the county regulates stormwater through this ordinance. We're required to adopt it. We do so in Chapter 10, but we have the ability to modify it if we want to. Not to make it less restrictive, but to make it more restrictive if we have issues. And obviously, we have a pretty big river running right through the middle of our community, and so we want to make sure we're not doing anything or allowing any type of development that would be detrimental to all the properties along that floodway and that flood zone. We, in this community, are one of only maybe 5 out of the 38 DuPage County communities that is considered a full waiver stormwater community. Now, what that means is we have full control in this community to make our, to do our own reviews, to make our own regulations, not regulations, to approve stormwater plans, floodplain plans, wetland plans. The benefit of that for Wooddale is we are lickety-split when it comes to turning around plans for people that are interested in developing here. So you can be basically a community in DuPage County where all of that stuff is reviewed by the county. Right now they're running about 12 weeks for a plan review. That slows, halts your development. You can be a partial waiver community, so you and your community have the appropriate staff that with the appropriate certifications to do just the stormwater, not the floodplain, the special management areas, the wetlands, but you know, the regular kind of stormwater reviews. Yeah, that's a partial waiver community. Here in Wooddale, like I said, there's not a lot of communities. We're full waiver, so we do all of that in-house, and most of our engineering reviews are done within a week. So that's a benefit for our economic development purposes. Another chapter is the sign code. Obviously, you don't want sign proliferation. Just as a matter of information, this coming spring, we are gonna be working a little bit more with property maintenance out of the police department to do some temporary sign increased regulation of that. The code does require it. Obviously, we wanted to be helpful to businesses during the pandemic and as they were ramping up afterwards, but that is something we're going to work on this spring as well. And of course, the building code. We adopt the National International Code Council building codes. We adopted about 12 of them. Most of them are about from 2012. But again, we can adopt more restrictive regulations or swap out some regulations, and we call those our local amendments. So every community is unique and does that. So that's all the background on visioning, regulating codes. Now we talk about process. None of this will be new to information to you, but these are the major steps in the development review process. When the staff does our reviews, you may not know a lot of this behind the scenes, but because when you see it, it's all packaged up nice in a little package. But what we get from the applicants is usually not really close to what you see. We review it for strict compliance with the codes I just mentioned, mostly the UDO at the development review process and stormwater. But we go through multiple reviews with the developers or you know anybody who's requesting relief. So we'll take a look at the plans. We'll say this does not comply with all of these items. We'd like you to use more durable materials per the guidelines. We want you to beef up the landscaping because it, you know, it doesn't look representative of what we'd like to see here in Wooddale. And so we go through many reviews to get them closer to compliance, and that's the package that you receive. Lots of times there's lots and lots of coordinations, emails back and forth, hundreds. Letters, maybe, you know, 2 up to, I've seen as many 5 review letters where we review it, send them a letter, they revise the plan, send it back in, we review it, and that happens 5 times. So a lot has happened, I just want you to know, before they get here, and we're trying to improve the plan so they're more acceptable for the community. Obviously, CDC evaluates it, the projects, and they evaluate it for standards of approval to make sure the findings of fact and the standards are met, in your opinion. Obviously, you are a recommending body, and that takes us to the next slide. These are the roles of the elected and appointed city officials in the zoning process. So you, as the CDC, are an advisory body. You make recommendations to the city council, and they are the ones that have the authority to render a final decision. So the city council makes all the final decisions pretty much on, and we're only talking about zoning process, but of anything, fiduciary and otherwise related to the city, they adopt the laws and the ordinances and the resolutions. The city attorney, we have legal advisors who do a fabulous job. They not only advise the city council, but they advise the CDC and the staff. We use them regularly to make sure we're, you know, within the confines of the law. the community development director. Now, this is all listed in the UDO. These are responsibilities of my position, but really it's, you know, the whole team in the community development department. We have a senior planner, Gosha Pocheha. We have a planner, Andy Kuteris. And we have a planning intern, Haley Nichols. And then there's other people in the department that do a variety of things. But really, we as a group do this. But of course, it has to assign somebody the responsibility. So I get that. And this is just the things related to the zoning process, not to all the other things our department does. But we review and administer the applications for the zoning relief, any amendments to maps or text of the UDO. We make recommendations to the CDC and the City Council for zoning relief. We administer and interpret the UDO. Now you should know that zoning type regulations and any kind of regulation really only plans for maybe 80% of cases will fall into those regulations. All the rest is gonna be gray or it's unique. And so there needs to be someone tasked with interpreting what the intent is and then making decisions in those cases. And so that would be something that the director role is responsible for. Enforcing the provisions of the UDO. So if we see or we hear a complaint that somebody's doing something that isn't in compliance, you know, this department will send somebody out to do an investigation or inspection. We are required to update the zoning map annually, and that's actually required by Illinois state statute. And we're coming up on that in March. We will be bringing that to you. And text amendments to the UDO to make it current. And I think, is this where you're taking over, Sean?
I will take over right here.
I am done. Obviously, any questions at the end, along the way, and now we get our legal expertise.
All right, thank you so much, Stacy. That was wonderful. I want to start by thanking you guys. You have a thankless job most of the time. You are all volunteers. You take time out of your busy schedules, take time away from your family to come here and help the city make really important decisions about how property is used in the city. And I've been working with you for some time. I see how hard you guys work, and I want to thank you, okay? Because sometimes somebody else says thank you, but I'm going to say thank you. You know, I used to be in my past life, I used to be a high school history teacher, and we spent a lot of time on talking about federal government, we spent some time on state government, and we spend very little time on local government. And in my personal view, and I'm biased because I represent local governments, it's really the most important government that touches everybody's lives. I mean, think about it. You're making recommendations on how people can use their property. It doesn't get more personal than that. So you do have an important job. You should feel important. You should pat yourself on the back. It was quite an honor that you were appointed to this position. So just start right there. What I'm gonna do for you tonight is I'm gonna go over just some of the nuts and bolts of the zoning approval process. And I think more than anything, I want you guys to feel comfortable asking me any questions that you have. You know, some of you haven't had the benefit of having a CDC training yet. And going back to my high school history days, there are no dumb questions here. So if you have a question, something's been nagging at you, please ask. If I don't cover it, ask your question anyway. This is your time. This is our time to workshop. Okay, so let me start with some of the basic requests for zoning relief that you get. Okay, you're gonna get folks that come in requesting a permit for a special use. You'll have folks come in asking perhaps for a variation from the code. Sometimes applicants will ask for amendments to the code. Sometimes folks will ask for a rezoning of their particular property. There's also subdivisions and consolidations. You'll also take a look at things called a planned unit development, and I'll cover that a little bit more later. But those are the basic things folks are asking. They're coming here because they need city approval to do what they want to do with their property, okay? Our zoning, in our zoning code, there's a lot of things you can just do as a right. You don't need to ask for permission at all, right? But when you get involved, it's because an applicant needs permission under our code to do something. I got it.
Okay.
Got a question?
Yes.
I don't know if you can, if you know the exact number, but how many would come to us with that variances or whatever?
Yeah.
And how many just go through the system without any problems? Like 10 to 1 or 15 to 1?
You mean folks who need to come in and ask for permission but don't?
No. In other words, guy comes in, he needs a variance.
Okay.
That's one unit, let's see. And how many are going through the system where we don't even see any?
Oh, there's
80 of them. I mean, you know.
Yeah, and so there's so much you can do as a right with your property. I would say probably
more.
You know, 90% of the things you can do with your property you can do as a right. You don't need city permission. 10% you do. And so that's when you guys get involved. Obviously, that's when the city council will make a final decision on it.
Are you asking, Dave, that do we see every request?
No, I know we don't see everyone, but I'm just saying, in a course of thing, course of a month, we get, let's say we get two up here.
Mm-hmm.
Is there another 20
that
we don't see?
That
they process,
everything's
fine. Yeah. I'm just wondering.
So,
number.
Can I?
Yeah, absolutely.
So, just as an example, and there's really no way to exactly know.
Right.
So, most of the things you can do on your property, like, should I say Sean?
Sean.
Attorney Conway,
yep,
said. Most of those things we can't know. We can't regulate because we don't know what people are doing. But for things you do need approval for, like you need a building permit for something, or you need a rental, you own a home and you want to rent it out, you need a rental license, or you need a, you operate a business and you need a business license or inspection and fire safety inspection. So we do probably, let's say 600 to 800 commercial inspections per year, up renewing people's business licenses. We have a few hundred rental licenses where we go out and we inspect every property, and we issue about 1,000 building permits a year. So that's probably 2,000 things, and we do a lot more than that, but those are 2,000 things where you have to touch us for something that's permitted and we need to basically approve it, where you might see 20. Yes.
So
I hope that helps.
Yeah, and a great example, Jay, is, you know, if you wanted to do an addition on your home, okay, if you're within all the zoning setbacks and everything, all you need to do is come in and get a building permit for it, get that approved. But if you need to get into that setback where it's prohibited by our code, where you're going to have to come in here and ask for a variation. So most of the projects, they don't need any zoning. I call it zoning relief, meaning, you know, you want to do something with your property, but our zoning code doesn't either allow for it, or it's what's called a special use. I'll go over that a little bit more. You need to specifically get a permit for it. Okay, but it's a great question. Most of what folks can do with their property, they're not going to need your approval or your recommendation of the city's approval. They'll just need the building permit. Okay, so in this next slide, you know, there's some things that you don't have to, that you're not concerned with, you don't have to resolve, all right? So for example, annexation agreements. When somebody wants to annex into the city, a lot of times the city and that property owner they'll enter into an annexation agreement, and that'll talk about, you know, various things that will need to occur with the property once they come in. Fortunately for you guys, you don't have to resolve any of those issues on annexation agreements. That's at the city council level. Development agreements. Sometimes we'll have a developer that'll want to come to town. It'll be a big development, might be very good for the city. Those development agreements will be negotiated by staff. Ultimately, they'll go to committee level and straight to city council. So you guys don't have to do any of the negotiating on development agreements. And that's a good thing, because all you then have to do is, you know, concern yourself with the zoning. Parking agreements is another example. Building and engineering approvals, that's all staff. City code enforcement matters, again, that's staff. Okay, so those are things that when folks come in for the zoning relief, you don't have to resolve those issues. You just have to determine, do they, you know, qualify for the zoning relief. Okay, next slide here. I want to first talk about a special use. A special use is, and it should be, one of the more easy types of zoning relief to get. Okay, to get a recommendation on and ultimately get from the city. And I'm just going to throw it out. I don't expect you guys to know this, but any ideas why the special use permit would be one of the easiest pieces of zoning relief to get? Well, you know, it's close, Jimmy. So what the city has done in its code is it's already made the decision that certain special uses are okay in a zoning district. The only thing you have to do as the applicant is come in and get the permission. So the city already at the city council level has said, we do not mind this use in this zoning district. Yeah.
Yeah, Potter, remember that thing with Potter Street? Where a lot of those things were listed? I assume that's a good example.
Yeah, yeah. So the city council in the code has said, okay, a school in this district is okay. We like that. That's fine. We just ask that you come in, let us know that you're going to put a school there, because we may want to talk about, you know, hours of operation or things like that. And so we want to collaborate on the intensity of that use. Maybe if we want to put some conditions on it, we'll put some conditions on it. But as a general matter, we like that use in that district. We just ask that you come and ask for permission. So a special use, you know, as you're thinking about it when you're making recommendations, you can have some confidence in saying to yourself, okay, it's allowed here. And so, you know, you don't have to be so strict about a special use. Yeah.
I think also it's specific, and with every thing that they want to do, say it's different, you pretty much, you can determine, is this going to be good or not?
Right.
I mean,
exactly.
Plant developing hazardous material, which is a very strong topic right now, you know, might not be the thing to do.
Right. Right, and now if it's already allowed in the code, you know, the city council has said, okay, that this use is okay, but because of the intensity, like the example you brought up, Jay, we may want to put some conditions on that. We may want to have some oversight as to how that use is going to go forward. So that's really what a special use is. The next type of zoning relief I want to talk about is something called the text amendment. And that's just a fancy way of saying somebody comes in and they would like you to change the code. Okay? So, for example, in one of the districts, truck repair is not allowed at all in the code, not even as a special use. Someone might come in and say, okay, we think you guys should add truck repair to the list of uses that are allowed, either as a right or as a special use where they could get a special use permit. That would be asking for a change in the code. Those are a little bit more difficult to get. And they should be, because you're changing your code now. But, you know, it happens all the time. I mean, we just had a huge UDO, you know, adoption process. That was a huge change in the code, lots of changes in our code. And we work with consultants, they said, okay, these changes we recommend, these changes we don't, but we often change our code. And I will tell you, because we've just adopted a new UDO, you may have a good number of folks right at the beginning coming and asking for additional changes, because it's so new. That's not uncommon. That happens in every community. If you think about, you know, the UDO, it's like a state law, you know, compared to state laws. Those are being changed all the time. Well, so can our UDO. What the courts look at when you're making a change to your code is if there is a rational reason for changing the code. And as long as you have a rational reason, typically a text amendment is just fine. All right, the next type of zoning relief is called a rezoning. Some folks call it a map amendment. And if you think about the zoning map, I'm sure you have seen the zoning map at some point in time, but it's on our website, you can look at it, and it shows all the district, the zoning districts throughout the town. And sometimes people say, okay, I'm zoned as a whatever, C3. But I'm right next to all the other properties that are zoned as C2. My property is better fit as a C2.
I didn't get that. Could you try again?
Okay, so I'm just going to. So I also teach sheriff's deputies, you know, on training. And I had training last week, and my watch kept going off like that. I'm like, what is going on here? So one kid said, well, it's your big fat hand. I'm like, all right, thanks. So in any case, a rezoning is when somebody comes in and they ask to change the district that their property is in. Do you guys have any questions on that? Sometimes it's a little confusing, right? So if you're C2, now you want to become C3. Now, why would you ever want to do that? Well, the uses that are allowed in C2 are not the same as C3. And maybe you want the uses that are in C3 because they better fit your property. That's an amendment, just like a text amendment is. So there just needs to be a rational basis for it. Yeah.
So if you were to change it, would that be permanent, even if they were to move out of that property?
Yes, that's a great question, Terry. Any change to zoning is going to what's called run with the property, right? Not with the owner, except, and this is new to our UDO, except special use. Okay, our old UDO said, if you get a special use permit to be a donut shop, the person who buys the donut shop will also get that special use permit. That was the old code. Our new code says it runs with the owner, unless in the ordinance giving them a special unit, we specifically say it runs with the property. Okay, but yes, an amendment
is permanent.
Is permanent. Now, I say that it's somewhat permanent because what could the city council do? Amend the code again. They could go back if they wanted to.
Would that be without somebody requesting it or just?
Yes, another excellent question. So there, typically you'll have somebody in the community ask for amendments, but also staff or the city council will ask for an amendment because they decide, okay, this particular regulation isn't working for us right now, we want an amendment. So staff or city council can initiate a text amendment that will go through the hearing process with you guys. Okay, the next type of, did I cover that? Did I go too far here? Let's see. All right, I want to talk about variations. I don't know where I'm at here. Variations, here we go. I always go off script, sorry. I should not even have a script. It's made true. Next one is variations. All right, now this is considered the most difficult type of zoning relief to get. Does anybody have any guess why this would be the most difficult? And just educated guess. I don't expect you to know this.
Well, yeah. I would guess that originally there was a reason why the code was set up as it was. Now you're going against that code when there was a lot of thought process on it.
Yeah, that's right on point, Jay. So with the special use, right, it's allowed. It's just you need permission. A variation that whatever you're trying to do is prohibited. The code prohibits it. So, for example, you want to build within that setback, and it's bringing that addition right up to your neighbor's property line. Well, why is it prohibited in the first place? Well, because there could be runoff issues. You know, you don't want properties right up on each other. So when somebody comes and asks for a variation, what they're really asking you for is, hey, can you make an exception for me? There's a particular, unique, hardship situation that I'm in, and I need an exception from the code. So it's basically you guys saying, okay, based on the hardship, based on, you know, the unique, very unique circumstances, we'll recommend an exception. But it's very difficult and should be very difficult to get. In fact, a lot of times what staff will say to folks like that is, you're better off asking for a change in the code than to come in and ask people to make them, you know, ignore the code, basically. And sometimes staff will say, you might want to just ask for a change in the code, because to ask the city council ultimately to disregard the code, it's a tough thing to do. Now, it happens. I mean, sometimes there are some real, you know, tough situations. A lot of times what you're looking at is it a tough situation that wasn't caused by something you did? You know, so for example, if, you know, IDOT comes in and they take a portion of your property, you know, it wasn't something that you had any control over, and now you need a variation because of something IDOT did. That'd be a great example of a hardship, but not of your own making, that, yeah, okay, we can make an exception for that. Okay, I covered this in terms of amendments to the code. You know, what the courts are looking at ultimately is there a rational reason for a change in your if there is, a text amendment is going to stand up against any sort of scrutiny. Special use standards. If for special use permits, we have standards that are in the code. But what I'll tell you is, in the staff memos, and I represent many communities with zoning, and I'm going to tell you, the staff in this community is top-notch. Is top-notch with the memos they create for you guys, with the standards that they go through, and they lay it all out. You know, they'll in bold face, put standard one, standard two, standard three, and they're gonna tell you if they think the standards are met. Okay, so definitely staff is here as your number one resource. I'm your number two resource. We work for you guys. Read those staff memos because they are so helpful. They help me when I'm looking through them and I'm trying to determine, is there a legal issue? You know, I heavily rely on what staff has concluded as well. So they're gonna go through the standards for you in the memos. And they're gonna tell you, in their view, have they been met? Okay, they will make conclusions on those. Variation standards. I already talked a little bit about variations and really what you're looking at when you're recommending a variation. Again, staff memo is going to lay out all the standards for the variation. What you're looking at primarily is hardship. You know, is there a particular hardship, a unique hardship, that would allow you to recommend a variation? Any questions so far? Okay, the CDC meeting procedure. You guys know this, you've been through it, but really just to review, you primarily what you're doing here is you're having public hearings, okay? This is the chance where the applicant gets to present you with evidence, testimony, documents. Sometimes experts will come in, and it will all be done under oath. Okay, that's their chance to convince you. It's also the chance for the public, the neighbors, folks in the community to voice their views on it, whether they support the request or whether they oppose the request. And your job is to listen to everybody, to listen to everybody's points of view. Ultimately, you're gonna be making the recommendation, but you know, what I don't know what the philosopher was, but you're given two ears and one mouth for a reason. To listen to everybody's different points of view. Okay? And then at the end of all that listening, you'll use your mouth. Okay, so you're gonna have the public hearing, you'll have the deliberations. Now, one thing I say every meeting, and I'm like a broken record. When we close that public hearing, we can't accept any more evidence, okay? And what does that mean? That means testimony. So if you have questions, ask them during that public hearing. Any question that you have, make sure you ask it during the public hearing. And of course, I'll always remind you, but you know, make sure you're asking your questions during the public hearing portion, because once we close it, now you're like, you know, you're the deliberative body. That's the chance where you guys get the opportunity to voice your views on the request, voice your opinions. You can have discussions amongst each other. Somebody can make a point, and somebody can say, thank you for that point. I respectfully disagree with that point. I think it's good for these reasons. And somebody else could say, well, thank you very much for your views, but I don't support it for these reasons. That's your chance to communicate with each other. It's also your chance to communicate with the city council, because these proceedings are being recorded, and particularly for those big zoning matters that we get, I can tell you, the aldermen watch these proceedings. They'll listen to you. Listen to your points of view. Listen to the applicants. And they should. That's their right to do it. So if there's a particular aspect that you would like the city council to consider, make sure you're using your microphone and say, I would like the city council to consider this when it goes up. Okay? So that's perfectly fine. That's within your role. Yeah?
Yeah, I think, you know, want to use the term for the good of the order. I think this deliberation is something we could do more of. You know, we hear everything, and then we go down the line, we vote yay or nay. maybe we say, okay, I'm in favor of, you know, granting this variation or whatever the situation is, and here's why. And then, as you said, if there's somebody sitting down, Teresa sitting down, the answer is, well, I think you're way off base. Let me know why.
Mm-hmm.
We're all friends. You know, we can agree or not agree, and I might say, well, I don't care what you say, I disagree with what you're saying. But the point is, it would be good not only for the group, but as you said, for the city council to hear a little bit of back and forth. And I think that's something we should underline and try to develop more as we go forward to the next case.
Yeah, and that's, you know, that's something, Jay, where ultimately it's everybody's personal decision how much they want to say on a particular matter. You know, some folks are, you know, it's not a particular zoning matter that they have of an opinion one way or the other. And so maybe some folks will just kind of sit back and say, okay, I'd like to listen to the points of view that are coming out on the dais, and then I'll vote. That's fine. You know, you're within your right. You don't have to say a word.
Right.
You don't have to. That's your opportunity. All I'm saying is that's your opportunity to, if you want to. You're not required to. You can make decisions without saying a word, if you want. Or you can say your piece. But that is your opportunity to say your piece if you would like to.
So along with deliberations, it's more of a statement, right? We're not really are we going to be asking each other questions?
You
the
can.
The questioning part kind of was during the public hearing.
So you're not asking each other questions in terms of like factual matters. If the question is, Jay, I'd like to hear your viewpoint. Are you in support of this? Okay, asking Jay his opinion. He may say, I'm not going to tell you my opinion, but I will vote on this matter. He doesn't have to.
Right.
You can ask him. In terms of like the factual matters about the request, you want to ask those questions. You guys aren't, you know, you're making just recommendations, okay? If you have a fact question, you want to ask staff, you want to ask applicants. First the applicants, okay? And then, of course, staff, if they know, they can chime in too. You're not going to ask each other fact questions, okay? You want to get the fact information from the witnesses, from staff, okay? Now, if you want to know somebody's viewpoint, their opinion, that's okay. You can ask them that if you want. You don't have to, right? Or you can use this deliberation opportunity to say why you support the request and your reasons why. Or why you're against the request and your reasons why. And you just make your statement.
Well, it's good for the applicant to know, too. If they're denied, they may know from what we say what they have to come back with to get it approved next time.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah, it's food for thought even as they go up to the next level,
right,
to the committee level or to the council level. Okay, maybe there's something, you know, that you've brought out that they have time to adjust before it gets to city council. Okay, so I've covered this. Public hearings are required for the UDO zoning relief requests. We also have a standalone sign code. It's not within the UDO, it's outside the UDO. But anything in terms of amendments to the sign code, variations to the sign code, those are things you guys would be hearing as well in a public hearing format. All right, this next slide just kind of covers some of the procedural rules in a public hearing. You typically have a chairman. Mr. Ochoa is our chairman. It's the chairman's prerogative to, if the chairman wants to run the meeting, the chairman can. If the chairman wants to have a meeting facilitator, the chairman can. A lot of times for the bigger hearings, Jimmy will ask me to be the meeting facilitator. And that's only just to keep the meeting going. I don't do any, you probably notice this, I don't make any comments on somebody's zoning relief request, either up or down. I run a fair hearing where everybody has the right to say their piece. That's really the central role of the chairman. The chairman or the meeting facilitator wants to make sure the meetings run fairly, that everybody has the right to say, you know, their piece. There's a member of the public. I want to make sure those folks have the right to say, you know, whether they're for or against a particular proposal. You want to give the applicant a right to say their piece in support of their application. We're governed by what's called Robert's Rules of Procedure. The formal Robert's Rules of Procedure is a book this thick. So I'm not asking you to memorize any of that. There's just standard motions. And at this point, you guys are really good with it. Typically, for the zoning request or for approving minutes or things like that, there's going to be a motion and a second. And all that does is it gets it onto the floor for a vote. If you make the motion or if you make the second, doesn't mean you're in you approve of the request. In fact, you can make the motion, someone can second it, and when it comes to vote, both those folks can vote it down. All it's doing is it's getting it on the floor for a formal vote. Common motions, motion to recommend, the zoning request. I always have you making a motion recommending approval instead of recommending denial. And the reason is because the state law has a specific vote requirement for approvals. It doesn't say anything about a vote requirement for denials. So I always have it done in the affirmative, meaning the motion is to recommend approval. If it doesn't get the required number of votes for approval, then it goes up as a recommended denial, okay? But it will always be done in the affirmative. There's motions to continue. Sometimes people call it motion to table. It just means we're gonna continue this matter till next meeting. We're not gonna resolve it at this meeting. Motion to recess just means that we're taking a break. And obviously motion to adjourn is to conclude the hearing or the meeting. Okay, I wanna talk about, this is something new that staff has worked on. I've worked on it with staff, and it's something we think might be useful to everybody, particularly in light of some of the major hearings we've had in the past year. I mean, I've been helping you guys for many years. And I gotta tell you, the last year with the UDO, with Radcliffe, we had a lot of big hearings. And I think maybe this would have been helpful with those hearings. What we're gonna give you with the packet, in addition to the memo that you typically get, you're gonna get this worksheet. And it's a one-page worksheet. And it's going to very briefly summarize the request, exactly what they're looking for, okay? And then it's going to, I believe there's gonna be the staff recommendations on there. Stacy, is that?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
It's gonna be the staff recommendations on there. And then there's gonna be a spot at the bottom for you to make your own notes about the request, okay? This is an internal worksheet. It's not something that's gonna be made part of the hearing record. It's just a worksheet for yourself, basically.
That's great.
Yeah.
That's a great idea.
Yeah. And at the bottom, you can write notes. Do you support the request? Do you not? Or maybe you have questions. You could write your questions down there. It's for your own use, okay? And if you want the city council to think about something, that's something you could put in the notes section and refer to it when we're in deliberations.
But if you want to refer something, case I've used before, I don't think you were here at that meeting, but I brought up about the tree thing with, you know, up here.
Yeah.
That I voted against the, I think you were here, I voted against the request only because I wanted more trees.
Right.
And I, as I thought about it later on, I said, you know, I should have voted in favor of this, but how do I let the city council know that we need, we should have more trees?
Right.
So would you use this sheet?
Yeah.
Would it go to the city council?
No. What you would do is, you'd have the sheet in front of you, right? You've got your note on there, and your note is, I don't like 20 trees, I like 40 trees. All right, so in our deliberation portion, you can, you could say, listen, I generally approve of this request. Personally, I would like there to be 40 trees instead of 20 trees. I'm not going to vote against this at this stage, but I would like the city council to consider 40 trees instead of 20 trees.
Now, you had mentioned that they watch these hearings, but is there a way, let's assume that for some reason only two aldermen watched it and the other six did not. Is there a way that that message would get to them, all eight of them, prior to the issue coming up on it?
So I think one of the things we talked about in the committee level memo, because we do a committee level memo too. In the committee level memo, staff was going to say, member Babowitz is requesting that city council consider 40 trees instead of 20 trees.
And so that will get to all.
Exactly. Yep, and that would be in their packet. Okay, so they'd see it on the video.
That's a real key, important thing.
Yeah.
Tagging on to that, I kind of feel that that puts us in a position where we're negotiating. Should we kind of be negotiating where it can have a financial impact on the developer and the applicants?
So here's the nuance. If, as a whole, you guys decide to put on all these new conditions, I would agree with you, Jimmy. Now you're starting to do a lot of negotiating. You're starting into areas that really the city council should figure out. You're right. Right. So what we're recommending is, instead of you guys doing negotiations and putting in all these new conditions, just say what you like, what you prefer, and then let the city council decide. And maybe they'll say, you know what, we've looked at member Babowitz's suggestion on 40 trees instead of 20. As a collective, we agree with member Babowitz. Let's approve 40 instead of 20. Okay? So it's a way for you guys to generally approve of a request or recommend approval or generally recommend denial, but then also say, okay, here's some adjustments I would make, and I'd like city council to consider those. Okay? That way, because, you know, we did have one situation where, and maybe it was the tree one, I don't know, where it seemed like everybody generally was in support of what the applicant was looking for, but it got hung up on a condition. And because, you know, that particular condition the applicant didn't agree to, I think everybody was like, well, we're not gonna recommend approval. And that applicant was like, yeah, I can't, for financial reasons, I can't do it. So they weren't agreeing to that condition. So then it went up to city council level, and I think at that point they worked out the tree issue.
Yeah, it did.
Yeah. So it's just a way for you guys to say your own thing, you know, say what you think the city council should consider, but not completely, you know, undercut the request if you're generally in support of it. Does that make sense?
It does.
Okay. Okay. So I have on here some other helpful tips. Now, I want you guys to think of yourselves, you're a very unique body under Illinois law. You're kind of like, you're a little bit more like a judge in a judicial case than you are, let's say, a legislator passing a piece of policy or approving a, you know, a piece of policy. And what I mean by that is you have to always be thinking about fairness in the hearing process itself, because that's a challenge that an applicant can bring, and it's a challenge that somebody in the community can bring, where they think the hearing process itself was not fair. Okay? One of the concepts of fairness is this thing called ex parte contacts. Here's what that means. You guys as a body are making recommendations. The applicant, out of the hearing process, let's say at Christie's or someplace like that, comes up to you and says, listen, you've got to convince these guys to go with my request. I need this. And now you're having a private conversation outside of the hearing process with an applicant who has a pending application. That, the courts say, could be subject to challenge. For example, let's say the neighbor is in major opposition to the request, and they find out that the chairman had secret private talks with the applicant that nobody else could hear about. That neighbor, when they bring it out, they're going to say that was not a fair hearing process, because there was a lot of convincing of the chairman that was done outside of the hearing process. Okay, so here's what you say when somebody can, this is the real world. Somebody may, it's likely that somebody will come up to you who has a pending application. If they want to talk to you about it, you say, listen, I appreciate you wanting to talk to me about it. My lawyer, our city lawyer, has told me I cannot. I'm so sorry. Blame it on me. Blame everything on me. Make me the bad guy. And say, our city attorney has told us I cannot talk about this application while it's pending before us.
So okay. It's not just the developer, it's like people opposed and in favor of residents too.
It's everybody who wants to talk to you about it. Say, I appreciate you want to talk to me about this. If you have strong feelings about this, I encourage you to come tell me during the public hearing. Okay? That's where you can really say your piece. That way, everybody has a chance to respond to whatever is being said. And it's all fair. It's all on the level. All right, so that's ex parte contacts. Conflicts of, yeah.
Using that conversation, last year when we had the RAPID going on,
mm-hmm. Yeah, so my recommendation is Radcliffe can have as many open houses as they want. They have the freedom to do that. But you guys are the decision makers. And you should think of yourself like a jury, almost, right? You know how a jury, the judge will say, I don't want you to read the newspaper. I don't want you to do that. You just listen to what's said in court. Think of yourselves like that. You're just listening to what's said in this room during the public hearing process, okay? So if Radcliffe or anybody else is having an open house, they have a pending application, I am strongly advising you guys not to go to that, because you want to hear what Radcliffe has to say, or anybody else, in this room, okay? Not outside of this room, because that's all within the public hearing process. Okay, that's a really good question. Any other questions like that?
Speaking of Radcliffe, can I ask a question about
mm-hmm.
that? So I have a friend that just moved in there, and I go and visit her. So if they come for us again, and if, say, say I run into Alan.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, we talked nothing about this. Would I have to excuse myself just because I say if I see him, you know, a couple times a week in passing, going to visit somebody?
No, no. So,
yeah.
First of all, they don't have a pending application before you know.
Right.
So you can talk to people, you can go over there, you can do whatever
yeah.
you feel, you know, that you're per complete freedom to do that. When an applicant has a pending application before you, and you personally know them, perhaps,
right.
or you just know them because they're members of the community, you can talk to them about what their kids are doing for baseball or basketball, or that's fine. You can't talk about the case, okay? And if they want to talk to you about the case, say, I have to stop you. If it's about the case, I can only consider that during the public hearing, okay? On words of our attorney, Sean Conway, and give him my phone number, and they can call me and yell at me, okay? But that protects you, it protects, believe it or not, the applicant, because if somebody in opposition to that request gets wind of, okay, there was a lot done outside of the hearing process, that's gonna hurt the applicant, ultimately. So, you know, they don't want that either, really. So, after it's out of your hands, okay, there's less concern about you guys because you've made your recommendation at that point, okay? I would still, you know, if that's happening, first of all, I would ask that you guys get a hold of us because, you know, there are times when I've had to intercede and say, okay, we've got to make sure that we're keeping this on a due process level. I'd prefer that city council not ask you guys individually either. I'd prefer that they watch the video. I'd prefer that they read the minutes of the CDC meeting. I'd prefer that they read the staff memo that's gonna summarize what you guys have determined. That's where I'd like them to get information on what happened at the hearing. So at that point, it's less of an issue for you guys, a little bit more of an issue for city council, okay? Those are all great questions. Any other questions on that? Okay, conflicts of interest. All right, here's a classic conflict of interest. Chairman Ochoa wants to build his addition in the setback. He needs a variance. Comes in to you guys and asks for a variance. Can Chairman Ochoa sit up on that dais and be the chairman? No, right? He has a conflict of interest because it's his own application. Okay, so that's the classic conflict of interest. There are a lot of conflicts of interest that really get into gray areas. And for example, your best friend since sixth grade is coming in and asking for zoning relief. You may feel, and rightly so, that you have such a strong personal relationship that you cannot be impartial, right? You have such a good relationship with that person. It's impossible for you to be a fair, impartial decision maker, right? Because really up there, you're referees. You're impartial, you're fair, doesn't matter who it is in the community. That may be a situation where you want to recuse yourself, okay? If you get into that situation, if you feel like you're in that situation, even if there's an appearance, they call it an appearance of a conflict, let me know specifically. That's more of an issue that I would, you know, almost everything else you go right to staff. For things like that, call me directly because I will help. Ultimately, I'll make a recommendation on whether I think you should recuse yourself or it's okay for you to, you know, maybe it's a situation where I look at it and go, that's not a conflict of interest at all, but you felt like it was. Mm-hmm. If you feel like it is, I encourage you to call me, okay? And that's attorney-client privilege, all right? That is between you and me at that point, okay?
So no motion needed to recuse someone?
No, no, you can only recuse yourself, okay? Now, here's why you would want to recuse yourself if it's called for. Again, that can impact the request itself, right? Somebody could challenge that request and say, there wasn't a fair hearing because Chairman Ochoa was impartial. They had a conflict of interest. And the whole zoning request should be declared void by the court. So that's why it's important to, if you feel like that's an issue for you, to get in touch with me. The last one is impartiality. I've already talked about it. Your main goal here is fairness. You're impartial. You haven't decided what you're going to do before you have heard all of the testimony, all the facts, you've seen all the documents. You know, you don't come out, you know, for example, you're on an email saying, you know, to staff, there's no way in hell I'm voting yes for this before you've even gotten to the hearing process. That would be classic denial of due process because you've closed your mind before you've even listened to the applicant. Okay, I just want to cover the Open Meetings Act briefly. All of our meetings, including this one, are subject to what's called the Open Meetings Act, okay? And the fundamental rule of the Open Meetings Act is all public meetings should be open to the public for them to hear what's going on and for them to make public comment if they're in the audience and want to make public comment. There are certain situations where you can go into what are called closed meetings. We never do that here in the CDC. Everything we do is out in the open. But just know, you're subject to the Open Meetings Act. We have notices that are posted. Staff takes care of that. The biggest thing for you guys to remember is the Open Meetings Act applies to email. And what the law says is it's a meeting if a majority of a quorum of the members discuss public business. Okay? It's a meeting if a majority of a quorum. Okay, so what is a quorum? We talked about this earlier with Chairman Ochoa. A quorum for us is four, okay, because we have seven members. So a quorum is four. A majority of a quorum is three. So what the Open Meetings Act says is three of you cannot have a conversation about public business outside of this room. Okay? So if there is a pending application, three of you cannot email each other back and forth and say, I don't like this about it. Have you been over there? I don't like how it looks. It's a bunch of garbage over there. I'm not voting in favor of it. If you're doing that outside of this room, you could draw what's called an Open Meetings Act violation. And the court could say, okay, I find that there was an Open Meetings Act violation, and I declare invalid any action that comes out of this body or at the city council level.
Is that before or after? By that I mean, let's say something is discussed, voted on, and on the way out the door, you talk about it.
So it still applies. Now, at that point, the court may decide, okay, we're not going to invalidate the action. We're just going to find that there's a violation, The court can issue fines if it wants to. The court can say, I find that there's a violation.
Even after everything's done?
Yep, yep. So you don't want to be talking about any matter of public business that, okay, let's say you're done voting on it, now it's up at city council level. Theoretically, they could push it back to you guys. So you don't want to be talking about it with the three of you. Now, if two of you want to talk about it for Open Meetings Act, that's fine. Okay? Three, no. So the rule applies to a majority of a quorum.
So if we vote on something, and on the way out the door, Jim and I talk about it, you and I are the only two that voted in favor of this, we say...
You're fine, under the Open Meetings Act, yeah. Because it's two. Yeah. Cannot with three. Now, where I see it gets folks into trouble most often, believe it or not, is emails. And lately, what the Attorney General has said is it applies to even private emails, like private email addresses. So if you're talking about public business using your private email, and three of you are doing it, you could draw an Open Meetings Act. So just keep that in mind. Here's the golden rule. Just here's the golden rule. If it's a pending matter, or if it's a matter that's up at the city council, everything is in this room. Keep it in this room. Okay? All right, we kind of went through some of the general requirements. There is Open Meetings Act training. Has everybody taken that? Raise your hand if you have not taken that.
Okay. Is that the thing we do when we first get
online?
With that guy from DuPage?
I don't...
It's usually
through the Attorney General's office. They have an online... It's usually through the Attorney General's office. They have an online training program.
How come we gotta do that? I mean, I think I did that 2.5 years ago. Is that a yearly requirement?
Let me check on that, Jamie, and see what the, it's usually when you have your new term. So I know we've got a couple new folks. If you haven't done it, what I'll do is I'll have Maura, our city clerk. She's really good. She does all the Open Meetings Act, all the FOIA training. I'll have her get in touch with you. All it is it's actually really good. It's through the Attorney General's office. You go online, it's probably about half hour, 40 minutes maybe. And it's all training about Open Meetings Act. And I think it's really helpful. I think it's really useful.
Yeah, I did it, but I don't know, we have to do it periodically or?
Yeah, it's usually when you have your new term. So I'll verify for you guys on that. And I'll check with Maura too.
I think
they're on staggered terms, or they should be anyway.
Staff has to do it every year.
We'll let you know. I'll let you know. I'll look into it for all you guys, and I'll specifically let you know if you need to take it. Okay. All right. What else? Okay. That's all I have for you guys. Open it up for any more questions that you have in terms of anything. At all. Now's your chance.
I have one.
Yeah.
It's a dumb one.
No, dumb ones.
So, say somebody brings something before us and you have a really strong opinion about it, whether you oppose or approve.
Yep.
And regardless of what happens here when it goes to city council, as a citizen and knowing probably, you know, everything from being on the board.
Yeah.
Can you go to the council meeting and speak at the public hearing being a commissioner?
Excellent question. And my answer to you, you probably don't like it, but I'm strongly advising no.
Okay.
Here's why. They could potentially send it back to you. There may be an aspect that they want you guys to consider that didn't come out through the public hearing process, they could potentially send it back here. And so now you're in the position of, it comes back here, but now you've made a public statement that you're not gonna consider that. Your mind's made up.
Right, so you'd have
right?
to recuse yourself.
Yeah, you have to recuse yourself. You don't want to be in that position.
Right.
You know, every time you recuse yourself, you know, the typically the zoning requests need a vote of four members to get a recommendation. Okay. And I believe that's for special uses too. Special uses didn't used to have that in our old code. I think in our new code, four members need to vote yes for it to be a recommended approval on everything. Variance, special use, amendments. If you're recusing yourself, now you've narrowed the universe of members. Let's say you are generally like the request or in support of the request. Now you've made it more difficult for the applicant to get a recommendation.
Well, what if you barely have a quorum?
Well, that's a good point too, Jamie. If you barely have a quorum and you're the applicant,
can they table it? Or can they?
They can certainly ask. And if I was their lawyer, I would say if I thought it was any controversy, I would ask that it be continued to the next hearing so that you have full complement of members.
And the applicant is within their full right to ask for opinions.
That's right.
How many opinions?
Well, I mean, that's ultimately up to you guys. I would recommend as your attorney, because you're always concerned about due process and fairness of hearing, if there's four members, you need the positive vote of those four members, and it's their first time asking for a continuance, typically I would recommend that you grant that so that they have a fair chance. You know, so next meeting, maybe there's five, maybe there's six members. Hopefully there's all seven. But, you know. But yeah, if you only have four members, it's real difficult to get that recommended approval if there's any controversy in the request. So. Great question. Any other questions? You guys are asking really good questions.
So if there's a council meeting going on that they do, I can't go to that if I want.
You can go to the council meeting. You haven't. Now, that's an excellent question. Just because you go to the council meeting doesn't mean you're expressing that you're in favor of the request or you're opposed to the request, right? You're just going to the council meeting. It's when you stand up and express your viewpoint at the council meeting that I don't like this, here's why I voted down at the CDC level, or here's why I voted up at the CDC level.